So, hi everybody, welcome back to our C++ programming lecture. That's already our 10th lecture, so a bit more to come, but we made quite some progress so far. And today we're going to discuss the remaining parts and bits of object-oriented programming. So that is the second part. We will also talk about type conversion and type casting, also in context of object-oriented programming. And then at last, the major block for today, it's probably somewhat of a, like a half or so, is file I/O. So how you can read and write data to or from a file, which comes in quite handy, of course, oftentimes in real world applications. So that's also very useful, and that's a must know. Okay, so virtual functions. We continue where we ended last time somewhat. So we already know about polymorphic call sites, right? That's a call site where we have some object of some declare type. So maybe a reference or a pointer type to some, yeah, declare type. But the underlying allocated type might be different. And then by the application of magic, or to be, yeah, I mean, for real, it was just the virtual function table. At runtime, it is decided what function, what virtual function in a class hierarchy to be called, right? So what function specialization should be called. That decision is made at runtime using the vtable. But of course, it's also possible to call the parents function or even the parent's virtual function explicitly. So say you have some variable of some concrete type that specializes, let's say, a draw function, for instance. Then of course that can be called, right? But you can then also call explicitly the draw function of your parent if you need that, if you feel that your specialization at some point is not desired, really. So maybe let's best have an example. So we have a struct A with some virtual function, the function which just prints the type name to the type's name to the command line here, in this case NA. Then we have a struct B which specializes that function in order to print B to the command line. I mean, that's the type's name, and of course it inherits from A. And then the same for another struct C, where we also specialize the function here, that virtual function, to print C to the command line. And then what we can have, of course, is, and I tried to explain that already here without code. So if we have a variable of the type C, we can, of course, call the member function function, C.function. And here in that case, of course, a C's function would be called. I mean, that is not even a polymorphic call site. I mean, that is declared and allocated type here in both cases is or are C or is a C type. And for that reason, if you call the member function C.function, of course, C's version will be called. But we can also call the parent specializations if we ever need that. So what we can do is the syntax for that would be the following. We would use C dot, and then we can differentiate and choose one of the parents function functions to be called. So C dot B colon colon function, and that in turn would call B's version or B's function implementation, which would print B to the command line. And since C transitively also inherits from A, we can of course also access A's implementation of that function, which would eventually print A to the command line. So that is just the syntax how you can call also the parents function if you ever need that. And they can even be virtual here as well, as we see here, because that very function is virtual. One more thing to keep in mind. We now talked about inheritance, like in the last lecture, right? Which is one of the main points of object-oriented programming. But there's also a different concept, which is called composition. And sometimes it also makes use to use composition rather than inheritance. So let me try to explain what I mean. So first of all, yeah, sometimes composition is more useful than inheritance. And of course, I can't give you a specific answer because as always, it really depends on the nature of the problem that you wish to solve. So depending on your problem, sometimes inheritance might be better. In other cases, composition might be better. It really depends. It depends if you wish to use polymorphism and all that stuff. So I really can't tell you, unfortunately. But what is the essence? What is composition? Imagine, like the fictional example here, you wish to model a band, right? So eventually you wish to have a class band. And of course, a band probably needs a guitarist, a drummer, a vocalist, maybe a piano player or whatnot, right? So, and what you could now do is, in order to model all that, you could have some classes. I mean, a class guitarist, a class drummer, a class vocalist, I don't know, a class piano player or whatnot. And then you could create a class band which inherits from all of those different band member types, so to say, such that the band overall also like inherits all of those individual features, such that a band is able to play the guitar, the keyboard, the drums, whatnot, bass maybe. That would be one thing. That would be inheritance, yeah, which is fine. But there's also the alternative called composition. And in composition, you would not inherit from the individual band members, but instead you would have those individual band members as members. So you would create, as shown here, right? So you would create a class band, and then you would have some data members of the required band members that make up the band. And then you also kind of have all the functionalities of the individual band members by having them as data members, right? And then you can make that also those functionalities accessible within that band class rather than using inheritance. So that would just be an alternative. And sometimes it's better suited for for your problem, depending on your problem, of course. And some languages like the Go programming language, as far as I know, they don't even support inheritance. So in Go, instead of inheritance, you always need to use composition. It sometimes has some performance advantages, but I won't go into details here at this point. And all right. So let's leave it there. Okay. So that was inheritance versus composition. And now maybe let's also compare templates versus inheritance. So templates is also another concept of C++, or another set of features, right? And we already discussed templates and all the template metaprogramming stuff and all that kind of things. So what's the matter with templates versus inheritance? When to use what? So that is a piece of code taken from the Phaser static analysis framework that I am developing and I'm the chief maintainer of. And as you can see here, we have, for instance, a class called an IDE tabulation problem, which of course models an IDE tabulation problem. So you don't need to know what that is in detail. So it doesn't really matter for that example. But as you can see here, we have that class, IDE tabulation problem, right? And you can see that we inherit from some other classes. So we inherit from some other classes. But also the IDE tabulation problem is also a class template. So it also receives template parameters. It actually receives two template arguments. So one analysis domain type and some container type, which is defaulted to a std set of something. And as you can see here clearly is you can use both concepts together. So both concepts are kind of orthogonal to each other. So you can use both at the same time, basically. and sometimes that's also quite useful. But typically, of course, you only really need to use both in situations where your problem is kind of difficult already, right? So for, I don't know, writing a simple matrix multiplication, you don't need such concepts, right? So you need to apply the right concepts for the right problems. But you can use them together as shown here. So inheritance and templates. So inheritance is vertical. We already discussed that last lecture. So you have an abstract type and then you can form a type hierarchy by inheriting from that abstract type and make it more concrete. And the further you go down in the type hierarchy, you more concrete, you, the more specialized you become. So inheritance is first of all vertical and goes from abstract to more concrete. Templates, on the other hand, is like horizontally. It defines parallel instances of code. For instance, you can, I don't know, you can, we had that sorting function, right? So that bubble sort algorithm. And you can, of course, sort, let's say, for example, a vector of ints, a vector of double, a vector of characters, a vector of anything, basically, which is somewhat comparable, right? Which you can order. And so it acts as a code generator, right? It will generate one bubble sort for integers, one bubble sort for doubles, one bubble sort for characters, and whatever you give as template parameters. So that is horizontally or horizontal, and it defines parallel instances of code. So in inheritance, we had that example where we had like an abstract shape and then we made it more special, triangle, right triangle. We had all those subtypes which became more and more concrete. And here, yeah, I already mentioned that example, sorting, for instance, and those are basically just copied pieces of code for the various types that you need to sort. But luckily, you don't have to write the copy versions yourself. Those are generated by the template mechanism. Inheritance is a runtime abstraction, right? So we had that polymorphic behavior for polymorphic call sites where the declare type may differ from the allocated type. And those polymorphic call sites know what function to call at runtime by looking it up in the virtual function table. So that happens at runtime, whereas templates are again a code generation tool. So yeah, and that is runtime abstraction, dynamic polymorphism, and here we have a code generation tool, static polymorphism. And I also already mentioned that, so both approaches here are kind of orthogonal. They can also be used in combination as shown here on the example, in the example on the right hand side. All right, great. Then let's talk about typecasting. First of all, in general, without mentioning object-oriented programming, and also then we have to mention typecasting in the context of object-oriented programming, because that can also be quite useful. So what is typecasting? It's basically having the same data but interpret it in a slightly different way. And here's a good example, in fact. So if you have one and the same actor and like playing two different roles, but in essence it's still the same actor. It's just, I mean, he or she is just playing different roles, right? So casting is a mechanism of type conversion, and that also happens implicitly for most primitive types. So most of the times you don't think about typecasting, it happens implicitly and typically rather naturally. So usually you don't think much about typecasting. So for most primitive types that happens implicitly. Be very careful when using explicit casting, because there you need to know exactly what you're doing, otherwise you can write broken code, so that's not what you wish to do. Typically the type system is your friend, so the type system makes sure that you use the types as intended. And if you now start to cast types explicitly, you act against the type system, which is usually not very wise to do. How do you perform an explicit cast? In the old, like C-style way, you did it, and in C you still do, of course, you would do the following. You have an expression on the right-hand side. It can be an arbitrary expression, I don't know, a sum of two integers, or just an integer variable, or just an integer literal even. So some expression on the right-hand side. And then on the left-hand side of that expression, you would, in parentheses, you would specify the new type that this expression should be casted to. And then that is called an explicit cast. But I only show it to you here as an example, so please don't use the old C-style casts. C++, or at least the modern C++ versions, have more explicit versions of that, like, general casting mechanisms. So please always try to use the C++ version of a cast rather than using the C-style cast. What is the reason for that? The C's rules for casting are a nightmare. You can look them up on the internet, really, and it's difficult. It's difficult, to say the least. So C++ is more explicit about casting. You can specify different types, different kinds of casts, which we will discuss over the next slides here. So, and therefore you should always try to use C's versions of casting. But before we start discussing all the explicit casting thingies in C++, maybe let's have some examples using the old C-style casting version. And let me show you what happens here. What we can do is we can have a floating point literal, right? That would be a double literal, in fact. And we can cast it to an integer. And then that integer that, kind of is produced here on the right hand side, that is stored in the variable I and initializes that variable I. And if you cast a floating point literal or any floating point number into an integer, so whole numbers without any significant figures, what happens is it's just a cutoff. So decimal, after the decimal points, all the figures are completely ignored. So that floating point literal would be casted to an int, and the integer would just be 12, so no significant figures. So it's a hard cutoff after the decimal point. Typically, you don't wish to do that. So in practice, most of the times, you wish to use floor or seal to compute the floor or seal, right? So, and those functions can be found in the header cmath. What else can you do? So first of all, that is most likely not a good idea to do that, what you do here. That a second thing gets even worse here, because you take a huge integer literal and you try to cast it into a short. And the short data type cannot fit that huge integer literal. It doesn't fit into the amount of bytes for a short. Which causes an overflow. So that's even undefined behavior. So that's not a good idea. So that's very bad. That is perfectly fine. So you can take the integer literal 14 and cast it to a double. So that would then just be 14 as a floating point number. And so you store that in the double variable d. That is perfectly fine. That's okay. So here in that case, typically in reality, you wouldn't even cast it to a double explicitly. You would just have a double d and you would initialize it with 14, and then that would be perfectly fine. Then an implicit cast would be done. Okay. So also what happens rather implicitly, and it feels rather naturally as well, if you have a computation which uses different data types, a good example is if you have a computation, and hopefully we will have a computation in the next line, which takes an integer and a double and a floating point number type. then that is automatically casted to the most precise representation involved. In this case, apparently it's a double. So what we would do, let's have a look. So we have our integer I, which is now initialized to 12, which we take here. And we would have the floating point literal, double literal, 12.5. And so that is a computation, or that is an expression that involves a double type and an integer type. And what would happen here is that integer type I, that would first of all be casted to a double type as well, because double is the most precise representation that is involved here. And then the computation is performed, and then the result is stored in the double variable p. So, and that all happens implicitly, and it just works. And to be honest, I really feel that is what you would expect, right? What you would expect to happen. All right, so that those are just a few examples here on explicit casting using the old C style. Then, before we talk about the C++ versions of casting, maybe let me have one more slide on the explicit keyword, which is also important in the context of implicit casting. And that explicit keyword prevents implicit casting, and then that can be quite useful from time to time. So let's have an example what I mean. You can create a type called my type, and that type can maybe have some data, some private integer I, and of course that type my type can also have a constructor which takes an integer as an argument, and then it uses the integer argument to initialize its own data member I. And in addition, we just give it the output stream, or the left shift operator overloaded for the output stream, such that we are able to print variables of that type my type to the command line. So far, so good. What we can now do is we can do the following, and here an implicit cast is involved. So we can have a function my make type, which acts as a factory, so to say, a factory function called make type, which returns something of type my type. So the return type of that function clearly is my type, because we just written it there. And yet, however, we return an integer, we return 42, which is, of course, an integer literal. And if we write some code, like in main, for instance, we create a variable t of type my type using that factory function called make type, then we can print it and it just works. Perfectly fine, no problem, all good. Why does it work? What happens here at this place where we return 42, which is an integer, but actually we wish to have a my type return type. What happens here is an implicit cast happens here. And that works because the type my type offers a constructor which takes an integer as an argument. So what you can do is you can, from an integer, you can create a variable of type my type. And so that is an implicit cast which happens here. And therefore, yeah, it works, right? So you can convert an integer to a type my type. That is typically the default, or that is the default behavior, but you can also prevent that by using the explicit keyword. Let's have an example how that looks like. So you can mark or declare that constructor to be explicit. And what that means is this kind of implicit conversion from an integer to a thing of my type, that doesn't work anymore. So if you use explicit, then a thing of my type cannot be implicitly converted from an integer. And in that case, if you use the explicit keyword here, you really need to explicitly mention that you wish to use that type, that you wish to use that constructor. It is not called automatically, as on the left-hand side. So here on the right-hand side, you explicitly need to state, yeah, I really wish to use that constructor, which takes an int and constructs a thing of type my type. And then the remaining bits, of course, work the same, but that's the difference. And sometimes that can be quite useful if you would disallow implicit conversion. Okay. So now let's talk about the various C++ casts that you can use. And especially the dynamic cast is very important and very interesting in the context of object-oriented programming, in the context of type hierarchies. That is very interesting here. So, and for the dynamic cast, there is a reference version and there is a pointer version. I explained to you both things and hopefully also like get the point to you what that buys you. So, first of all, it goes hand in hand with object-oriented programming, which is probably a good thing. So, what can we do? Maybe let's create an example situation where we can use a dynamic cast and then we see what it does. So, first of all, we create a struct A and we have some virtual function F and also virtual destructor. First of all, it must be polymorphic, so we need at least one virtual member function in order to make dynamic cast work, otherwise it doesn't buy you very much. And then we can have a second struct B, which inherits from A. And then we can have a struct C, which also inherits from A. And then we can have a struct D, which inherits from B and C. So what we would do is we form such a diamond structure. So, but that's no problem here in our case. Those types B, C, and D, those don't override F here, no problem. That's not important to prove my point. So what we can now do is we can do the following. We can now create a variable of the most derived type, D, right? In the type hierarchy, D would be at the bottom. It would be the most concrete type that we can have in the type hierarchy, in that diamond shape type hierarchy. So we create a variable D of type D. And what we can now also do is we can take a reference to that concrete type D variable D, and we can create an A reference to that D. That would be called an upcast. And here in that case, you can use a dynamic cast, but it's unnecessary. So in that case, that would just be called an upcast, and that's perfectly fine. So what does that mean? What happens under the hood? You have to keep in mind that D, the variable D, of type uppercase D, that is transitively inherited, or that transitively inherits from A. So D, first of all, is also of type C. D is also of type B. And transitively, D is, of course, also of type A, right? So those inheritance hierarchies form an is a structure. And D, the type D, is the most concrete thing, the most concrete type in that type hierarchy. And A, of course, is less concrete. It's more abstract. Because in D, you can, for instance, specialize stuff. You can add some more data members that A is not even aware of. You can extend A, for instance. And so what you're doing here is by taking an A reference to a variable D of type D, that basically means that you are ignoring all of the B parts, all of the C parts, and all of the D parts, right? So what that means is literally you are ignoring everything that has been introduced and specialized in B, C, and D, basically. So you are ignoring parts. And that's perfectly fine, right? I mean, D is still an A, and here you just, by taking an A ref, you just use it as if it were an A, or of type A, I should rather say. Okay, so, and now we can go ahead, and we can now also start downcasting stuff. So now we have that A reference to an A. And we can take that A reference and downcast it using a dynamic cast to a B reference. And so that means that that A ref, we go back to B and check if that can be casted to a B. So that means the A reference, of course, refers to a concrete type. And the concrete type, of course, we know that, is D. And what we try now is we now try using that dynamic cast to take that A ref and downcast it again to a B ref. So we are trying to use the underlying allocated object as a B reference. And that cast would succeed, right? It would succeed because the underlying object that this A ref refers to is D, which is of type D. And D is, of course, also a B, because D inherits from B. So that would also work. From that A ref, we can go back to a B and interpret it as a B ref, because the underlying allocated object is D, and D is also a B. So we can take a B ref to that underlying object. That would be called a downcast. And then we can also insert a small type hierarchy that we just produced here. We can now also do a sidecast. Why sidecast? Because, yeah, you can think of it as the diamond structure here that we produced here using the inheritance or type hierarchy. And B and C are on the same level, right? And so we now have a B ref to the underlying object of type D, allocated type D. We have a B ref and we now sidecast it to a C ref, which is kind of on the same level. That's why it's called a sidecast. It casts to the side. And that cast also succeeds because the B ref, of course, refers to something of type D. And since D is also a C, we can take a C ref to it. And only kind of care for the C parts of that underlying allocated object. Whew, yeah, that is a lot to take in, I believe. Maybe on the next few slides it gets more clear, but keep that in mind. You can kind of ignore information. Yeah, maybe that's a good way to put it. You can ignore information. So if you have a very, the most concrete thing here, you can just create references of some types higher in the type hierarchy, which are more abstract. And yeah, I mean, that just ignores more concrete information that may have been added in the more concrete types. I hope that makes sense. I know that's tough, but okay. So that would be the reference version. There's also a pointer version, so you can play the same game using pointers as well. So let's have an example. We have a base class and we have some virtual member function f, and we also have a virtual destructor. And then we have a struct derived, which derives from base. And then what we can do is we can do the following. We can have a base pointer, which we let point to the allocated type, an object of allocated type base. So we allocate something with new on the heap. And that allocated thing here is of type base. So we allocate an object on the heap of type base and have a base pointer to it. Perfectly fine. And now we can check. We can now check using a dynamic cast if the B1 pointer can be casted dynamically to a derived pointer. So can we take create a derived pointer from that B pointer? And if that cast succeeds, if that dynamic cast succeeds, then D will be some valid pointer, and then you can use D as if it were derived in that if branch here. And if the dynamic cast fails, the dynamic cast for the pointer version, it returns a null pointer, and then in that case that if branch here would not be entered, because that overall expression here evaluates to null, to the null pointer, and null is obviously false, so you would not enter that if branch. And what do you think? What do you think? Would that cast succeed here in this situation? And the answer is no. The cast here would not succeed. Why is that? So let's have a look what happens here again. So we have an declared type base pointer, and the allocated type is also base, which is abstract, right? So in the type hierarchy where we have base and derived, base is the more abstract type. And then we try to get a derived pointer from that B1 pointer, which points to something of allocated type base. And that does not work because derived is more concrete, but the actual allocated type of the object on the heap is something more abstract, is of type base, namely. And so that can't work because we can't make up information, right? So the allocated object of type base misses information. It misses the derived parts, and therefore we can't get a derived pointer to that object. Because, yeah, it just misses the derived parts. It's just a base. It's more abstract than derived. So that would evaluate to the null pointer here, and therefore we would not enter that branch. Let's have another example where that works, in fact. So we can also have such an example where we can have a base pointer. So declared type on the left-hand side is base pointer, B2, of the variable B2. And here on the right-hand side, we allocate on the heap some object of type derived. Some derived object we allocate on the heap, and then we have a base pointer to that derived object. And first of all, why does that work? That works because we have that very type hierarchy, right? And in the type hierarchy, derived inherits from base. So the derived type is also a base type, because those inheritance hierarchies form an is a structure. So a thing of derived type is, of course, a derived type. But in our case, it's also something of type base, because it inherits from base. So meaning you can take a base pointer to a derived object. And so what you can now do is you can use that base pointer and try to cast it into a derived pointer, or to a derived pointer. And in that case, the cast succeeds because the underlying object that this base pointer B2 points to is actually something of type derived. So you now get a valid derived pointer D, which you can use here within that if branch. So first of all, I mean, also that message would be printed, but here within that if branch, you would also be able to use that D pointer because it now points to an object of type derived. And at the very end, of course, be careful, you need to use delete, first of all, here in order to free the allocated memory here on the heap, base and derived. Or you would use smart pointers, and that would be done automatically for you. Okay, so that was the pointer version. So you can have a reference version and a pointer version. And basically what we implicitly did here, we checked for the is-a relation with a dynamic cast. So let's have another example. So we create ourselves a new type hierarchy A, some virtual function F, and then we create some new types B, which inherits from A, C, which inherits from A, and D, which inherits from B and C. So again, we have that diamond structure. And in order to check for an is-a relation, you can use the reference version, as I also showed you on one of the previous slides. And of course, such dynamic cast can also fail, of course. Same as on the last slide, where one of those pointer versions failed, right? But if we have references, we can't just return a null pointer to indicate that the cast failed. For the reference version, we need to use exceptions. So if a dynamic cast fails, because it cannot like dynamically cast to the desired reference type, then an exception is thrown. And for the pointer version, we already had that on the last slide. There we typically just check for the null pointer, because in the pointer version, the dynamic cast would return a null pointer, which we can then check for in an if, or using an if. So let's have an example. So we create a variable d of type d. So the d variable is of allocated type d. And then we can try to create an a reference to that d. And in our case, what do you think? Would that work? The answer would be yes, because d is again of allocated type uppercase d. And uppercase d transitively inherits from that a. So we can take an a ref to that d variable. And so we would be able to successfully just execute what is in the try block. If that dynamic cast fails for any reason, in that case it would succeed, but say you're trying to dynamic cast to some completely different type, then that cast would fail, and in that case a bad cast exception would be thrown, and then you can handle that in the catch block. And so here, if you enter that catch block, the exception handler, namely, you would know that the cast apparently failed. We can also have that as the pointer version. Again, as on the last slide here, and in our case, let's have an example. We can have a d pointer to an object of type d, which we allocate on the heap. And we can use the dynamic cast to try to get an a pointer to that object which is behind the d pointer. And of course, in that case, it would also succeed. And we would enter that branch, and if that evaluates to the null pointer, in our case we would enter the else branch here. And then of course remember that we also need to delete what we allocated here on the heap. All right, so that is how you can also check an is a relation. If the cast succeeds, then you know that the thing that you try to cast into another thing is also of that type. So here again, a D is also something of type A, or at least whatever is behind that D. All right, okay, so now let's continue on not dynamic cast, but const cast. You can also do even worse things here. So you can cast constness away in at least some situations. And again, that's not very wise to do, because typically the type system is your friend, and the type system should prevent you from making errors. And if you declare something as a constant type, why do you declare something as const? Because you wish to make clear that you can't change that thing, right? So, but you can do anyway with violence here with that const cast. You can remove constness when the underlying type is not const. What does that mean? Let's have an example maybe. So first of all, I already made that point very clear, I hope. So that is bad style. You should avoid it. You should avoid working against the type system, because namely the type system shall prevent you from making errors. There are some very extreme situations where that may be needed, but I won't go into detail. So at least here's an example if you ever need to do that. So what we can do here is we can have a function modify, for instance, which takes a const int ref. And of course you can use that const ref int, const ref to an integer in that function as if it were an integer, but you are only allowed to read from it because it's const, right? So you are typically not allowed to write to it. But what you can now do is you can say, yeah, I would like to const cast, and that is the syntax here, I would like to const cast that I variable to an int ref. So by doing that, you remove the const basically. And then you can write to it because it's no longer const, because you just casted that const away and made it an ordinary integer ref, which is not very good. So let's have an example that uses the modify function, and let's also have some in place example here. So first of all, we create an integer I, which we initialize to 3, and we note that the I is not declared as a const. So that underlying integer here is non-const. And we can now take a const int ref to that integer I, which we call C ref I, constant reference to an I. And if we would try to write something to that constant integer reference here, of course, that would fail because it's a constant reference. And we can't write to it. We can only read from it. But once again, you can just say, okay, yeah, please ignore that const it to an int ref. And then I can write to it because it's no longer const here. And really, that would modify the value. And this works because the underlying type, which would be that thingy here, the underlying integer I that this reference refers to, is not const. And therefore, you can cast the constness of that reference away. So here's another example where we have an integer variable, which is also not const, and we initialize it to 1. And here we call the modify function. And after we call the modify function, that other variable would carry the value of 100, which we just wrote to that underlying integer here. All right, so that should be enough, I believe. Then also we have a reinterpret cast that is also a thing that converts the type by reinterpreting the underlying bit pattern. So you can, I mean, if you have a value in memory, of course, it's just a bit pattern, right? It's a sequence of bits. And a reinterpret cast just reinterprets the bit pattern as something else. So it returns a different interpretation of the same, of the very same bits in contrast to those other casts here. Let's have an example. So we can store a few bits in an integer variable, which we call bits. So an integer is 4 bytes, right? So here this variable gives us 4 bytes to play with. And in C++, we can also write binary sequences directly by introducing the literal with 0b. So if we use that OB, that means that what follows is a bit sequence. That's binary directly. And then we have a sequence of ones and zeros, and we write that binary sequence into those 4 bytes variable called bits. And in decimal, I checked that, so that binary number here in decimal would be 394, if you're curious, but it doesn't really matter for that example. What we can now also do is we can use whatever value is now stored in that bits variable and reinterpret that bit pattern as a double reference type. And then we store that double ref in a variable called d, and that would just give the double value 6 pointer, blah, 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 doesn't really matter, but we can just reinterpret those 4 bytes here as some 8 byte double as well, if you ever need that. And then we can, of course, print it and all that good stuff. You very rarely need it, really. I just want to mention it here for completeness. There are a few example uses where you need to use reinterpret cast. If you, for instance, have to implement some device drivers that is required, then you need a reinterpret cast. Also, if you need to fiddle around with shared object libraries, I mean, writing device drivers, I don't know, not many people do that anyway. So the most frequent use is probably if you need to fiddle around with shared object libraries and you need to reinterpret cast certain things to make it work, depending on the situation. So those are a few examples, but that is in general not very often needed. And at last, I believe, we have that static cast that we need to discuss, and that is just performing an explicit cast. So if you don't have a dynamic cast, because you don't have any kind of type hierarchy with polymorphic behavior, if you don't wish to use const cast because you don't need to cast constness away, which you shouldn't do, and if you also don't need to reinterpret a bit pattern, then you would typically use the static cast that would kind of, if you are not in one of the aforementioned situations, then you would use the static cast as kind of an ordinary cast. And this just performs an explicit cast. And it is being used for casting in hierarchies, for instance, with non-virtual member functions or on primitive types. That's the kind of ordinary cast. In the old C style, I already mentioned that to you, you would have an expression and then in parentheses to the left of it, you would have the new type and then that would mean a cast. Here's an example once again. And in the C++ style, you would write it like that. You would use static cast and then in parentheses, you would give the desired type that you wish to cast your variable into. So that is basically equivalent to that usage. All right, and of course we can also have implicit conversions. I also already talked about that. So if you try to write that double literal here into an integer variable, it would just cut off after the decimal point. So that would be interpreted as an integer 3. Then that also works. You can also write an integer value into a double variable, which would implicitly cast to a double, and that would basically then be a 3.0, right? And that is also very common, right? So you can implicitly cast everything that is not zero to a bool, and everything that is not zero is interpreted or is casted to a true. And if you have zero, zero is interpreted as false. That is also yet another implicit conversion. Okay, just one minor note on GoTo. there's another keyword in the C++ language and also in the C language, which I did not mention so far. And it's called GoTo. What is GoTo? It's an evil mechanism, so to say. It performs an unconditional jump within a function. When to use GoTo, so never mind, I will also have an example. When to use GoTo if you would like to introduce bugs, if you would like to make maintenance impossible, if you would like to make your program unreadable. And GoTo is not really needed because every program that contains a GoTo, or the GoTo keyword, can also be expressed in a program without GoTo. So there are also very limited applications of the GoTo keyword. Typically, it's only really error handling, but even then you can introduce mistakes here. So be careful. Let's have an example how you can use that mechanism. So what do we have here? So we have a main function. We have some integer counter which we initialize to zero, and then we can just have some token followed by a colon. So we can have a label and then a colon. What does that do? That thing here represents a label. So in C and also C++, you can have labels in your functions. That is called a label. And for convenience, I also called it label here. And then what you can do is you can, I don't know, print the counter. You can check if the counter is smaller than zero. Then you can increment the counter. And then you can go to that label. And go to, as the name suggests here, or as the word suggests, it performs that unconditional jump to the very label. So go to label means that the flow of execution should continue at label, which then again prints the counter variable. It checks if the counter variable is smaller than 10. If it is smaller than 10, we increment that counter and then we jump back to that label, which brings us back up here. So that is GoTo in essence. And you can also do some more stuff. So at some point, of course, that counter variable will be equal to or greater than 10, or at least in this case, it will be equal to 10. And then we don't enter that if branch and we just continue with what follows after that if, which is that double for loop. And then here we can also have a check and da, 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 and if that condition evaluates to true at some point, we can go to that other label, which we called end loop. And if that condition is true and we execute that go to here, basically, we continue our execution at that very label. And we would just print a new line at the very end. So yeah, that's how go to works. There's some restriction. You cannot jump across functions. So that would be insane, right? So if you could have a go to and then you just leave the function and just continue elsewhere in your program, that is not possible, at least not using GoTo. If you wish to do that, you can use set jump and long jump, which I also just mentioned for completeness. But that's really not something you should use. And I really leave it there. So no more comments on that. What else? With GoTo, you can introduce great bugs. That was a famous bug in some of Apple's code base, I believe, if I recall correctly. You can also just go on the internet and Google for famous GoTo bug Apple, and then you will probably find a detailed explanation here. But that was some security critical code. And of course, programmers are lazy and programmers also don't do the braces, right? And that's all bad happened here at the same time. And you do copy and paste. And by some reason, you end up having two GoTos here. And that's exactly the situation I mentioned here, where GoTo is used for some like error handling and then you return at some point. So you have a common exit point here. I don't know. That's just very bad. And the problem here was that you check for some error, and then in error case you go to fail. But the problem was that that second go to fail is always executed, right? That I mean, if the if branch evaluates to true, then this go to would be kind of executed and you would go to fail. But then there's another go-to which does not belong to that if branch, because I mean there are also no braces, right? So that if only refers to the next very statement. So you go to fail, the fail label in any case, and which completely skips that SSL raw verify function call here. So that is never called, and you just never verify some security critical stuff, which is apparently bad. And then despite the name here, that always returns it's okay. So that's not a very good verify sign server key exchange, right? Because it doesn't verify anything, it just returns okay. That is really, really bad, and it costs a lot of money. So that was one famous example on how GoTo can fail quite literally. Good, that was it about casting. Then for the second part of this lecture, let's talk about file IO, how you can read and write from and to files, and that would already be it for today. So IO, first of all, if you're not familiar with programming or are completely new, file IO, that stands for input output. So file input and output operations. The question is how to get huge data into and out of your program. So typically a program processes some data, right? And for that reason, you need to get some data into your program that the program should process. And after it processes the data, it of course typically also needs to output some result. And of course, oftentimes you wish to write the results back to a file as well. So we need to be able to write and read from files and to files. So use files, and there are kind of three different sizes, I would say. So the data to read or write from files may be, first of all, small, of course, medium-sized, and huge. And there are several ways of doing that, of doing file I/O. And I present to you the most convenient ways. There are certainly lots of other ways. As always in C++, if you have a problem, there are a million ways you could solve the problem, and then it's your kind of duty to find the best possible solution in that solution space, right? So I present to you the most convenient ways of doing all that. Oopsie, what's wrong? Okay. For text files, for binary files, and also for serialization. I will explain those three things to you. And for serialization, also text versus binary serialization. So, apparently you agree, hopefully you agree that reading and writing from files is important, but there's one thing. If you care for performance, reading and writing from and to files should be reduced to an absolute minimum, because that is the most expensive operation on your machine that you can perform. That is really, really slow. That is really, really slow. So file operations are slow. If you look at the memory hierarchy that I have taken from Wikipedia, this is like speed versus capacity. And it proves my point, hopefully. So, memory. So first of all, your computer, of course, has some processor registers, right, where it can store some data. And this is, of course, the fastest data that you can access, or the fastest kind of memory that you have in your computer, that you have in your machine, the processor registers. However, those are very expensive because they are directly mounted on the chip, and that is, or on the cores even, and that is really, really expensive. So you can only have a little amount of data in the processor registers. You only have so many registers in your processor, right? So small size, small capacity, very fast, and also unfortunately very expensive. Then your processor also has some cache. Typically also some layered caches, like of the size of several MBs, several megabytes, which are still fast, but by far not as fast as processor registers, and still very expensive. So like the cache is some small memory, which is also directly mounted on your CPU. It can hold some small amounts of data, small capacity, several megabytes typically. Very fast as well, very expensive, and limited. Then you have your main memory, your RAM chips, your random access memory, which is still somewhat fast, but it is of course way, 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 way slower than cache, and even more slower than processor registers. So compared to processor registers and cache, memory is almost, yeah, it's like absolutely slow. But there you can have several gigabytes typically, right? So your RAM chips, I don't know, my machine at least has, my small laptop here has 16 gigabytes. So, and it's affordable. Yeah, you can buy those machines. And probably your modern smartphones also have such amount of main memory. But the storage for those thingies here are only like short term. So if you turn off your computer, I mean, your RAM chips are blank again, right? And so that's not for long term. For long term, you have then flash USB, which is even slower, but also cheaper, and it can store some data even if you turn off your machine. Same holds for hard drives, right? And then eventually, even today, you still have tape backup, which is very, very slow, but very, very cheap as well. And it can store really terabytes in more in terms of data. So, what else did I want to say here? Yeah, and if you read and write from files, I mean, it's typically a hard drive, right? Which is way down here in that hierarchy. So it's slow. More details on that in the high performance lecture, which we will do some of the next times. And yeah, I should leave it there, I guess. So, writing text files using the standard output file stream, std opstream. How would you do it? So you can have some data. Let's, for instance, say we have a string and we initialize that string with a data is, colon, space. Then we have an integer I, which we initialize to 42. And then we create an output file stream. And we give it some file path here. So we give it some file path, myfile.txt. And then the constructor now tries to open that very file that we specified here. The constructor now tries to open that file. So we can then check if that file could be successfully opened. And so we can use the member function isOpen on that variable of type output file stream, which we just named OFS. And hopefully that thingy returns true. And if that file could be opened successfully, we can now write data into that file using the left shift operator. So we can write that string literal hello world and then a new line to that file. We can also write the string, which is that one here, the string's contents and the integer value here. We can also append that or write that to the output file stream. And then at some point we can close the output file stream. And then we can once again check if that output file stream could be successfully closed. And then this is open method, that is open member function, should return false. And then we are done. So what happens here on the right hand side? We open an output file stream. We write some formatted data to the file stream. We close the file stream. And we can, of course, check So we can also use open instead of using the constructor to open a file stream or a file, really. So open, we could also write it like that, where we just use the default constructor and default constructor variable output file stream of type output file stream. And then we can use open explicitly in order to open that file rather than on the left hand side where we use the constructor for that. So that is also alternatively possible. Depends on your situation. That might be a bit more convenient. Close is not really necessary here in that case, because those SDL objects are RAII objects. So resource acquisition is initialization. That also means that the destructor is implemented in such a way that if the OFS variable goes out of scope at the very end, its destructor is first of all called, and the destructor is implemented in to close that file automatically. So you can't forget that close, and therefore that call to close is not really necessary. So again, file streams are closed automatically when the destructor is being called, and that is when they go out of scope. So that means that you cannot forget to close. But let's imagine you have a very long scope, maybe even with some heavy loops. Then you can also, of course, use close manually to close that file stream if you no longer need to write to it. So there are also some open modes, so that's in essence the same code. But here in that case, you give a second parameter to the constructor of the output file stream, and you give a mode, you specify a mode. If you try to create a new text file using the constructor as on the last slide without that second parameter, then a new text file is created. In that case, that would be just a text file. A new file is being created. And that also means, and here please be very careful, that also means that if you have existing files with that same name, those existing files are overwritten and are deleted. So be very careful. If you have some important files called myfile.txt, make sure you save that elsewhere or rename it or whatnot. But if you just do it without the second parameter, then that would be overwritten. But there are different modes possible, and that is what the second parameter here is for. And that is the mode append, app. And that means that the existing file is not overwritten, but rather whatever you now move into the output file stream, whatever data you store into that output file stream variable, that is appended to any existing files, to any existing file, myfile.txt. And if no such file existed yet, then a new file is created. All right, so here are the important open modes. Typically, I mean, I don't know. So either I didn't use any open mode at all, and then I created a new file every single time, or I used append here, so append to existing files, but I never really used the first or the last mode, but yeah, you can look it up maybe sometime. Sometimes it might be useful to you. And that was writing text files. You can also read text files using the input file stream. And how would that look like? So that would look like the following. You create a variable, myfile, of type input file stream, and then you give it a file name, myfile.txt, for instance. And that would try to open, that constructor would try to open that file, myfile.txt. And so we could first of all check if that file could be successfully opened, and then we can do some stuff with that file. And else we can, in this case, we just notify the user that we have not been able to open that file, and then we would just return. But in case the file could be opened successfully, we can, for instance, use a for loop to read the file line by line. And that is a convenient way to do it. So you can use a for loop where you introduce a new string, which is called line. And then there's a very commonly used function, which is called std_getLine. And the getLine function receives as an argument a file handle, and it reads the current line and writes the current line into that output parameter line, which is of type string. So the second parameter is actually passed as a reference and serves the purpose as output parameter. And then getLine reads the first line, and then the result is stored in that string variable line, and then we print it here in the for loop's body, right? And then getLine returns true if it could read a new line, and it returns false if it has reached the end of the file. So, and this is why it works in that loop. So that is the middle part of the for loop, right, which checks the condition, and here you just check the return value of getLine, and then you can, in a nice for loop, read a text file line by line. So once again, high level, what does it do? It opens an input file stream. It reads a text file line by line until the end of the file is reached. And std_getLine here, that function might be the most used function for reading text, really. And that getLine reads from a stream until it hits a line break, and then it stores whatever is read until that line break backslash n into that std string variable that is passed as a reference here, and eventually it will stop reading lines when it hits the end of the file. And at the very end, the input file stream is closed, and here we don't do it explicitly, it happens automatically, because when the destructor of that variable myfile is being called, the input file stream will be closed automatically. So what else can we do? We can also read formatted text files. And that is typically done in, I've seen that in computer graphics, for instance, where you have some very simple data formats. And there that is used, what I'm about to show you. So let's write some code. We can, for instance, have some new input file stream variable ifs, which we create by opening that file. first thing that we do, we check if that file could be opened. If not, we just, I don't know, print an error message here to the user, to the command line, could not open file. And in case we could open that file, we just read the file line by line using the getLine function. And then in the for loop, we have each line available in that string variable line. And we can use that string variable line to create an input string stream, which you can find in the header file string stream. And so we can have the variable ISS, International Space Station. That's also what it could mean. So we have that variable ISS of type input string stream. And now we can read from that input string stream in a formatted way, which is really convenient oftentimes. For instance, again, in computer graphics. And in computer graphics, I mean, you have those triangle meshes, right, which describe, I don't know, some objects, right? So you have those triangle surfaces. And a triangle, of course, typically, I mean, in computer graphics, you always have like 3 points of data, right? So that's also why I made up that example here. So we have 3 integers, A, B, and C, right? And so we can now read from that input string stream, and we can try to read in 3 integers, right? So from that input string stream, we wish to read 3 integers and write those or store those values that we just read in those integer variables A, B, and C. And if that thing returns kind of false, no, just give me a second. If it returns true, then this is false and we don't break. Okay, so if as long as we can read something, then it's all fine. And we print maybe here, for instance, in that example, the sum of the 3 integers. And in the other case, we just break and we leave the loop. So if that failed here for some reason, or if there is no new line anymore, we break and leave that very loop. And so what is that going to do? How does the underlying data look like? So that code would work, for instance, if you have like a text file where you have a bunch of lines in your text file, and each line would contain three integers. So each line has 3 integers separated by a space, and then you could read that formatted data in exactly that way. So it would read line by line, and from each line it tries to extract 3 integers with that input string stream variable ISS, and then you can do some stuff with those integers, for instance. So once again, it reads a file line by line. For each line, an input string stream is created. You can read formatted data from those input string streams, and that's a nice way of reading formatted data. However, that code is a bit naive. So if you have ill-formed text files or ill-formed data files, so to say, your code would directly break. So probably before you start reading your file, you wish to validate if the data is like formatted in the correct way before you start reading it here. So that please be aware that this code is a bit naive. It's very fragile if the code is ill-formatted. You need additional error handling. And that's also, you always need that, right? So whenever you read data from the outside world, you also have to assume typically that this could be malicious data, right? That could be data provided by an attacker to get into your system, to poke your system with a stick. So you need to be very careful when reading data from the outside world, from outside of your program, right? All right, so that was reading and writing files and reading line by line. But for larger files, reading and writing line by line is slow. At least it's not very fast. So that is not suited for large files in the megabyte or gigabyte range. If you have several hundred megabytes or even gigabyte files that you wish to read into your main memory, that doesn't do the trick, right? So files then should be written and read in one or more blocks. And the fewer blocks you read, the better. And one example here I show you now is how you can read a complete file in one go. That would be a function for that, right? So let's for instance create a function which we call readTextFile, and it should read the contents of a file which we specify here by a std string with the path, and the text file should be read into a string which we can then manipulate in our program. So what we try to do is we create an input file stream using that path. Then we create a string stream, then we create a string contents which should eventually hold all results. Then we check if that input file stream could be successfully opened. That is, by the way, another way to check if the file could be opened. So rather than using the member function is open, you can just give the variable directly, and the variable implements the implicit conversion operator. So that is one operator I haven't told you about. I will do probably next time or so. And so that variable can be implicitly converted to true or false. And that basically in essence means that evaluates to true if the file could be opened, and it evaluates to false if the file could not be opened. And we try to read the whole buffer of that input file stream in our string stream, and then from the string stream we create a string which we eventually return to the caller of that function. So that would be one way to read a text file in one go. And I guess that should be enough on that. Then if you have yet larger files, say you have files of, I don't know, like say you need to open a file, or you need to write, yeah, or read a file which is 20 gigabytes in size, but say your machine only has 8 gigabytes of main memory, then you have a problem, because you can't read the whole file in your main memory, right? You can't, because I mean the whole file is 20 gigabytes say, and your machine only has 8 gigabytes of main memory. That does not work. And what do you do then? What you typically then do is you use memory mapped files. And what is the idea? So first of all, reading and writing files with a std file stream is fine. And still, I mean, IO operations on disk are slow, and reading huge files is expensive and slow. And there's another approach, namely this memory mapped files approach. And the idea is, if you have really large files, to only map portions of a file into the much faster main memory. So kind of you keep your file on your hard drive, and you kind of create a window, a frame in memory that moves back and forth on that file on hard drive. You can think of that as an abstract model or a mental model. So you map only portions of a file into your much faster main memory, where you can manipulate it in your program. So in C, you would use the function mmap, which is quite a beast. And so that's not a very easy thing to use, but it can be done. And in C++, you would typically not wish to use mmap, but rather you would use memory or mapped files from the Boost library. We will talk about the Boost libraries in one of the later lectures. They provide quite quite a set of very convenient and useful features. And so they also provide types that allow you to read or to memory map files. And in C++, you would rather use that. And you would use it if you have like gigabyte files or terabyte files even, which you know there is typically no chance to put it in main memory, right? So here's an example, but I won't care to explain all the details. So I would just refer you to the Boost documentation. But the idea is the following. So you would configure your memory mapping using some parameters, right? So you have your mapped file parameters in a variable called params. And then you would do some setup. Yeah, you say which file you wish to map to main memory, what kind of portions you wish to map, so what should be the size of the chunks mapped into main memory. you do a more complex setup here, and at some point, of course, you open that file and then you read that file. And that is how you can use it. For all the details, I just refer you to the Boost library documentation here. Just look for mapped file, memory mapped files, Boost, and then you will find it. You can also, of course, write in that way. You can map a file to your main memory and then write to it, of course. That also works. Also here in this situation, I also don't care to explain the details. If you ever need it, look it up yourself. You don't very frequently need it, really. So, I mean, when was the last time you needed to read or write a terabyte size file? It's not very often, typically. So, how to read files? In summary, of course, it depends on your problem and it also depends on the file's size. So, files up to several megabytes can be read and written line-based, using getline, for instance, if you have text. And then you can use the left shift operator, right shift operator, getline, and all those useful functions. Files up to several hundred megabytes and gigabytes can be written block-based. Here you would just use read buffer, for instance, to get a string stream, and then you can work your way from there. That is also perfectly fine. You would allocate buffers and read and write whole blocks. And then if you have files with sizes of several giga or even terabytes, you can read and write them using memory mapping. And what if the state of objects have to be restored or stored in the first place? So how about if you don't wish to write some data, like some text or like some numbers, integers? I mean, that's all easy, right? Relatively easy. But what happens if we have a rather special problem? What if we wish to store the state of a variable? What if we wish to store the state of an object in C++? If you need to do that, then there's something which is called serialization. You can use serialization. So what is serialization? Let's talk about that. Serialization is basically translating your data structures or your object state in a format that can be persisted. So you, what you do is you transform your state of the data, the state of a piece of data, the state of a variable, of an object, you convert that in a bit stream, which can then be stored and then it can also be loaded again. What you would do is transform objects and data into a one-dimensional bit string, which can then be persisted. And usually you can store it as a file on a disk. You can also store it in a memory buffer. That is also possible. You can also transmit it across the network. So you can serialize objects, C++ objects, and then transfer them across the network, and then on some other machine, like deserialize those objects again. And the state can be, I already mentioned that, the state can be reconstructed later when you need it by a process called deserialization. That is the opposite. And that can happen on the same computer, but it can also happen on some other computer. For instance, if you transmitted it across the network. And what that gives you, or what that buys you, is if you serialize data that way in a bit string and then you deserialize again, what you end up having is a semantical clone is created from that stored data. So you produce a clone which is undistinguishable from the original thing that you serialized. So, and that's tremendously useful. For instance, if you have to store intermediate results, for instance, that's a common area where you need that. If you have some intermediate results which you need to store in between some processes, for instance, then you can use serialization. And you can also use it for caching, just to name two examples. There are, of course, plenty of reasons why you wish to use serialization. And maybe one word on serialization. It's very simple for plain old data types, so for pod types, but it can get arbitrarily complex when dealing with pointers or references. So if you have more complex data types, like complex graph types, then it's very difficult to serialize. It's not impossible, but it's a bit more challenging. And serialization is very simple for simple types, as we will see on the next few slides. So let's have an example on how you would use a text serialization using Boost, using the Boost library. So that's something you would not wish to do by hand, but rather you wish to use a library. And in our case here, I use the Boost library for serialization. So how does it work? What do we need? First of all, we need IO stream. We need file stream because we wish to store the serialized data into a file. And we also need some Boost header files. Namely, we need Boost archive text output archive. And we need Boost archive text input archive. That's what we need. And let's have a more or less realistic example. So let's create ourselves a vector type, vec3. That vec3 type, let's give it three private doubles, x, y, and z, right? And that vec3 can, for instance, then represent a vector in the vector space R3, for instance. Then we have some public section where we have a default constructor, which would just initialize x, y, and z to 0. And then we would have a second constructor, which takes three double arguments, and it uses those three double arguments to initialize its data members x, y, and z. And then for convenience, we also overload the left shift operator such that we can print a variable of type vec3 to the output stream, to cout, for instance. All right. So, and now if we wish to serialize that data, or if we wish to serialize variables of that vec3 type, we need to do the following. First of all, we need to give access to Boost, right? Such that the Boost library is allowed to access the private data members x, y, and z. And you do that by writing the following line here. You would say, yeah, the class Boost Serialization Access, that is a class, it's a type, that class should be a friend of our vec3. And then this friend class is allowed, because it's a friend, it's allowed to access the private data members, x, y, and z. And then we provide a function called serialize, which is a template function, or a function template. It receives one template argument, archive. You can name it whatever you wish. It doesn't really matter, but in our case, maybe to make it a bit more readable, let's name the template argument archive. And then that serialize function receives as a first parameter a reference to that archive type and a const unsigned int version integer. So that integer is used to kind of handle versioning. And then how do you serialize that data here in that vec3 type into an archive? You just use the reference variable r, and use the ampersand. So the ampersand operator here is overloaded in that case. What does it mean here? You can now append data to the archive. So the archive as a reference here, you can just append x, you just append y, and you append z. That means that you store x, y, and z to that very archive that is provided here as a reference parameter. Okay, that is how you would spell it. And what you can then do, and this is where the magic happens, you can first of all create a new scope. Let's create a new scope here such that we can see what's going on. So in main, we first of all create a scope. And then within that scope, we create a vector variable v1 and we initialize it with a second constructor and provide the arguments 1, 2, and 3. Here, observe, implicit conversion is going on because we provide three integer literals, but they are converted to double literals and used to initialize x, y, and z, the data members of vec3. Then we can print the variable v1 to the command line, and it will print 1, 2, 3, as expected. So far, so good. Then we can create an output file stream. So let's create a new file, which we call seervec3.txt, which should hold our serialized data, or we use that file to store our serialized data. And then we create a variable of type text output archive, which is within boost. So you would type boost colon colon archive colon colon text output archive. And you give that variable name, here in our case, OA, output archive, for instance. And you give it a file, or you give it something it should store the data in eventually. So here we give it that file, the output file stream, because we wish to serialize to that file. But you could also, in theory and also in practice, you could also give a network connection or something else here where to serialize to. And once you have produced the output archive, which will eventually write to that file, you can just take your vector variable v1 and append it to the output archive. You serialize it into the output archive. And then this operator, this left shift operator, is overloaded for the text output archive within the boost library, and it will eventually call your function, your special function serialize. Serialize will be called by boost in the overload of that operator, in the implementation of that operator, and it will like save the state of v1 into that output archive. So far, so good. And then the scope is being closed. That means everything here in that very scope goes out of scope and is destroyed. So all the destructors are being called. And then let's open a new scope where those variables no longer exist. And let's see how we can restore that data that we just serialized. And here's how. First of all, we create a new vector variable, which we, I don't know, construct using the default constructor. Here it doesn't really matter. So we now have a variable vec3 default constructed. We create an input file stream. So we now again open the file that we previously written. We try to read from that. And we create a variable of type text input archive, IR, which we give that input file stream because we wish to read from that file eventually. And then we can use the right shift operator, which is also overloaded on the text archive type, IR, in order to read a vector variable from that input archive. And so here in that line, we produce a semantic clone from the data that we previously written to that archive or to that file. And if we then print that vector again, it will still print 1, 2, 3, because we restored the state by deserializing what is stored in that text file. Does it make sense? So if you don't believe me, you can also type that into your favorite text editor and compile it, and it will work. So isn't that great? And you can not only serialize in text, but you can also use binary format to serialize data. In that case, you wouldn't include a text output archive, but you would include a binary output archive and binary input archive, the serialize function, and the friend declaration here stays exactly the same. It's all the same. And the only difference then being here is that you create variables of type binary output archive instead of text output archive. And other than that, it's exactly the same. And then you can create a new scope and read that data back and deserialize that data back. And here also you have a binary input archive rather than a text input archive. And to make clear that that file stores some binary data, I don't know, I have used this suffix .bin in order to denote that binary data. But I mean, you can name it whatever you want, right? So notes on serialization. Other structured text serialization formats are possible, of course. You can also serialize in XML, in JSON, and in whatnot other formats are what's quite modern. YAML is a quite modern file format. For all the details, please have a look at the Boost documentation about serialization if you're interested in that kind of stuff. And also, please do not forget to link with those external libraries. I mean, if you implement a program in C++ and if you use stuff from the STL, that's very convenient because you can just use the STL stuff and the compiler will automatically link the STL implementation against your program. That happens automatically by the compiler. But if you use an external library such as Boost, you also need to keep in mind that you need to link against that library. So that is typically done by the dash lowercase l compiler option. So if we assume that you have a system-wide Boost installation, that would be the way you would type the command, the compile command. Say you have a program in a file called myprogram.cpp and it uses the Boost serialization stuff, then you can compile it. And at the end of, or in your compile command line, you also need to have that dash lowercase o Boost serialization to tell the compiler, or in that case, that is that part here is even for the linker, to tell the linker that the linker should also link that object file that is produced here, link that object file against that Boost serialization library that is installed on your machine. Otherwise, if you don't do that, then your compiler or the linker eventually, which runs in the second step, the linker would then complain and throw some undefined reference errors at you. And whenever you read undefined reference to and then some symbol, that is the linker complaining that it can't find a library or it can't make the links necessary to produce an executable binary. All right, so then maybe let's discuss text versus binary serialization. So you can, first of all, of course, use text serialization. It's use plain text. You can use XML, JSON, whatever other structured text format. And it's human readable, which is a good thing, I believe. You don't need extra debugging tools. You can just read it. It's also independent of the computer architecture. You don't have any size-off issues in the sense that if you use binary and maybe you serialize on one machine where an integer is 4 bytes, but then you deserialize on another machine where the integer or where the size of an integer is all of a sudden 8 bytes, then you run into issues, right? That's problematic. But if you just write it in text, I mean, 42 is always 42, right? So there's also no little endian versus big endian issues, and it can produce smaller results when most numbers are small. And if you use binary, typically it's a bit faster, uses fewer CPU cycles. That is important when the input-output is the bottleneck of your program. Other than that, it's also perfectly fine to use text serialization. It also lets you ignore serration between adjacent values. For instance, let's say you need to store a bunch of integers. Then if you serialize that in text format, you need some spacer in between two integers, right? You need to separate those integers using, I don't know, a space or a special character or whatnot. And in binary, you, of course, don't need that because typically an integer, for instance, is, let's assume an integer is 4 bytes, then you just have 4 bytes followed by the next 4 bytes followed by the next 4 bytes with no intermediate characters that separates them, because you can just read 4 bytes at a time to get back all of your integers that you stored. And that can produce smaller results when most numbers are large. But this is of course also dependent on your computer architecture, which is not so good. In general, there's no right answer. What I mean with that is not so good. I mean, you need to take care of that. That's what I mean. In general, no right answer, depends on your problem, once again. And yeah, I would say that would be good enough. Maybe some last notes on serialization. So serialization is very easy when using simple data types. You saw it using the Boost library for our VEC3 data type. I mean, that's really easy, right? It's not very hard at all. And it gets more complex, unfortunately, if you deal with more complex types. So if you wish to store the state of a complex object, which is of some complex type, like a graph type or that kind of stuff, or even if you need to serialize derived classes, that's also, then you not only need to store the parts of your own type, but also the parts of the parent types, and then it gets all of a sudden a bit more tricky. Yeah, pointer reference data members, I already mentioned that, lists, graphs. It's not impossible, but it just becomes a bit harder, right? What about arrays? Luckily, Boost is quite a good library, and Boost already provides implementations that allow you to serialize arrays. So Boost knows how to serialize built-in arrays, and also Boost knows how to serialize STL containers. So that's quite neat, because then you can just throw a complete container into the Boost archive, and Boost takes care of serializing and also deserializing that for you, which is quite neat. If you wish to get more details on that, please look up that web page. It provides an excellent tutorial on how to use it, if you ever need that. Later on, we will also have a dedicated lecture on useful libraries. And there is one large library provided by Google for serialization and deserialization. So for exactly that kind of issue. And that library is was implemented by Google and is now open source. It's called Google Protobuf, or Protobuf stands for Protocol Buffers. And that provides means for a language neutral and platform neutral serialization mechanism. So you are not only able to serialize your data using C and C++, you can, but you could, for instance, also deserialize that very data in Python or in some other language on some other platform. So you can serialize on using C++, for instance, on your laptop, and then on your mobile phone, you can deserialize that same data in Java using Android on your mobile phone. So that's also quite neat, but of course I can't explain that to you. It would be completely out of scope and far too much content to explain it to you in detail. But just as a pointer here, you can look that up yourself if you're interested in. And I will also explain a few more words on that in the special lecture dedicated to useful libraries. So recap. Then let's recap. What did we discuss today? We finished and finalized our object-oriented programming part 2, so you know all the important concepts of object-oriented programming. We talked about typecasting, what various types of casts are available in C++ and how they are useful and what they actually do as well. And then we talked about file I/O, reading and writing files, dealing with files in blocks, memory mapping files, serialization, and yeah, that would be it already. So, all right, thanks very much and see you in today's exercise class. Bye-bye.